simple steps to modern mindfulness.
Oh, you have this swearing in there. Alert.
Yeah. The first one, you become mindful. Mm-hmm. And then the step two, try to tell others how to live their lives based on what you know. I love this. Yeah.
Because don't we all do that?
Because I just got interested in this. Now I want to tell you how you should live your life.
Yeah. And even when I might not be living my life.
Did you go through this step
totally.
Too?
Totally. Yeah.
How was it?
Oh.
Or are
humbling.
You still
I'm still there.
No, I haven't seen that you would be there, but did you experience it?
Yeah. Yeah. Of course.
And then you become even more mindful and the step four is realize you know nothing and finally shut the fuck up. Melissa Giorgio, I was just wondering how you say your name.
And you said it perfectly.
Yes.
Very good.
Hey, great. And thank you for coming and have this discussion with
me. Thank you for having me here, Ilona. I'm nervous.
Are you?
But between the nervousness and the Finnish summer, the heat.
And I'm nervous because I'm using English. Mm. It's not my mother's language. But we will get through this.
We can do it.
Yeah, we can do it. So you've written a great book about mindfulness in Finnish. It's Arki helpommaksi. Mm-hmm. It's in two languages, actually. Yeah. Which one was the first?
I wrote it in English, and then the translation was done by Tara Lang. So my Finnish is not yet there yet. My Finnish is not yet.
It's
good
not
enough.
It's not good enough.
No.
But Tara Lange may help you with them.
Yes.
Because the translation is actually very good. I have read this in Finnish, but I also have the English version here. Yeah. So, what made you write about mindfulness?
Well,
Big question.
But I don't know about you and all of your writing, but for me, I write about things that I need the most help with. And that goes for my children's books about emotions. And now this book about mindfulness was more for me, really, to sort of consolidate everything that I've learned. And then, you know, I love it. And it's sort of the foundation of everything that I do in my life. Try to do.
Yeah.
And so it was really for me. And then I guess I thought, I think this could really help people.
Mm.
And so that was the next step. It was for everybody else. And then, it just started as a few little paragraphs and just turned into a book. But it's a short book. It's an easy book. Mm. And that was my mission, to write a book that was really easy to understand and, like, just digest, basically. Mm. Because I think mindfulness and meditation can be seen as a little bit mystical.
Yeah, and we will talk about that later. Yeah.
And so I just wanted to, like, debunk those myths and just take it from a kind of, like, well, can I just keep talking?
Yeah.
So I kind of, when I was writing the book, I was thinking to myself, I'm taking a reverse approach to meditation.
Yeah.
Because I started out by meditating and then it morphed into mindfulness.
Mm-hmm.
But this book is about mindfulness, and then you can do the little bits of mindfulness in everyday life.
Yeah.
And then you might want to, you know, go into meditation after that. So it's a little bit of a reversal.
Yeah. And that's why, actually, I personally like this kind of tiny book ideas.
Yes.
Because I think that there is so much books that are just overwhelming. They're like too long, too much stories, too much explanation.
Mm.
I have always liked tiny books. Maybe it's because I'm a slow reader. So I like something that it's easy to take, but still, even though this was a tiny book, there was a lot of, I thought that the content was very deep and it was hardcore, but you didn't kind of fall into that trap that you started to explain those small, simple things.
And that's why I say in the beginning, you know, one of the steps is in life, but in mindfulness as well, not to take it so seriously.
Yeah.
It's just to hold it lightly.
Yeah.
You know,
that's a good idea. Mm. So you are a educator mm-hmm. and you also educate educators to yeah. do their work.
So better. I was a school teacher in Australia and then I took my master's in education here in Finland. And since then I've done a little bit of teaching here, but yeah, I've moved more into helping teachers do their thing, but also teaching mindfulness, teaching mindfulness to children and to adults at the adult education college here in Töölö.
That is so important. That is so important.
Well,
I wish my teacher would have had this knowledge when I was a kid.
It's all an experiment. Yeah. So, and when I started teaching mindfulness to children, you know, some, well, 15 years ago now, it was just an experiment. And luckily I had parents who were open to it and the kids were open to it. And it was just a really nice way to ground the group.
Yeah.
And then, you know,
get
deep with the rest of it.
Hey, Melissa, what got you interested in mindfulness in the first place? Like, what was like... You lived in Australia, I guess.
Yes.
Oh, you have lived in many places in Japan and everything. Yeah. But how did you come up with it, or where did you hear it, and why did you get interested about it?
Well, I think I've always been a little bit sensitive, or still am, very sensitive person, and you know, a lot of anxiety sort of runs through my veins. Mm-hmm. Naturally, it's just my tendency. Like, you know, if someone were to drop a spoon right now, I'd be like, somebody's, you know, been shot, you know, like I'm very nervy. I'm that sort of person. And then as I started maturing and, you know, into adulthood, it turned into anxiety and I just got sick of it. So I heard that meditation would help with that sort of thing.
Was it like you went to a doctor or you went to some counseling and they said that, have you ever heard? Or
no, I just got sick of myself and, you know, just via discussions with friends about this and that and the other. And maybe somebody said, oh, have you tried? Actually, I went to like a Buddhist retreat with somebody for a weekend and I had a really nice experience and I sort of got hooked and just wanted to keep going with it. So, yeah, I started that way.
Going and into retreats.
Yeah.
Because in the book, it was really funny how you wrote that, okay, if you think that these retreats is something like very exclusive, then just, you know, why don't you peel a few potatoes and wash your floors and then you know what retreats are all about. Was this Buddhist retreat like this?
Yeah.
You
yeah.
worked there.
Yeah.
How was it? How was it? I've personally never been into Buddhist retreats.
Yeah.
I've been to several others, but I've never been there.
Yeah.
So how was the first experience for you?
Okay, well, it was really magical and it was kind of surreal because I hadn't experienced something like that before and it was in a monastery that was right in the middle of the Australian bush and it's in the Theravadan tradition of Buddhism.
Like in the middle of nowhere?
Middle of nowhere.
Okay.
Like
how many hours did you drive there?
A good few hours.
Okay.
And then we had a secret code to a gate and I don't know if I'm giving away something about this special retreat.
Okay.
But then we drive in and no electricity and nothing, you know.
Did they take your phone away?
Yeah, I think at that time I didn't have a phone.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
oh, yeah.
Like it might have been.
Yeah.
So anyway, we'd go in and... And then the first time we went there, it was nighttime. So, you know, it was kind of just, you know, you don't know whether somebody's an axe-wielding homicidal maniac or is it going to go really well. But it went really well and we just meditated and I didn't know anything about it. Like I literally knew nothing about it. I'd heard that there was something called meditation and that you sit there and we just started. And I had a really nice experience. It's hard to put into words.
When, how many people were there? Were you?
Only 10? About five or 10. Yeah.
Oh, so like very small, intimate. Wow.
Yeah. And then after that, it was really nice, but it was really a stark contrast after being, you know, in the middle of nowhere for a few days to even get into a car and drive out and see all of the lights and the movement and everything that happens in life. And you think, oh my God, this is awful. You know, I can't believe I used to live like this. And then 1 week later, I'm living like that. So, you
Again.
Know, it doesn't take long to, you know, dip in, but also it doesn't take long to come straight back out.
Okay.
You know?
But so it was a positive experience.
Yeah.
You didn't like, because I remember I've been into a Buddhist meditation session, when I was maybe 20 years old.
Yes.
And I remember that I got anxiety from sitting still.
Yeah.
And I was like, I can't do this. And what are these people doing? And I get, you know, but you didn't have this kind of experience.
I had something, an experience like that. But like I said, it's really hard for me to describe, actually. Like, mm-hmm. it was a sense of not feeling okay in my own body and wanting to escape, but then also having this like little moment of like clarity or insight that actually I'm okay just the way I am.
Like, and feeling safe with yourself or something.
But it was just a touch, just a little bit. Mm. And then I, you know, dropped straight back out of it. And I guess since then, I've always been chasing that little bit of, you know, insight that I had.
Yeah.
So that's why I kept going and trying different things and trying different types of meditation and all of that sort of stuff. So it was sort of a hobby. And then, you know, I just continued meditating. And then, as I wrote in the book, I thought I was pretty good at meditating, like I had it all worked out, which is a joke in itself because, you know, you
can't. What do you mean?
Can't be good at meditating.
Okay.
Because, you know, something like this, meditation, mindfulness, you know, we want to attach goals to everything. Westerners, we love it, you know, because we want to see an end point and we want to get there. And of course, I was even doing that because I'm competitive, you know, with myself. So I was just trying to, you know, get to the next step or whatever and sit for longer.
Be enlightened somehow.
Yep. Have those moments of enlightenment. And then, anyway, I was meditating and that was fine. And I would sit every day. And in fact,
like how long were the, like 15 minutes or hour or
like
2 hours?
Minutes and things
just
like that.
Just sit.
Yeah. Just sit and just, you know, watch the breath and watch my thoughts and blah, 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 and, you know, become really zen. And, you know, I just felt really good about myself. Then my son came into my life, my darling son.
Yeah, darling son. But before that, do I remember right that you even went to this John Kabat-Zinn meditation?
No, it wasn't his.
Or whose was it?
To do my teacher certification?
Yeah.
Yeah. It was run by Alan Wallace, who's a Buddhist.
Alan Wallace. Sorry, I mixed because he's also.
Yeah, okay. They're all in the same crew.
Yeah.
And so him and Paul Ekman, who is a master of emotions and how they work out. So that was, to work out how to use mindfulness and meditation to notice your emotions. And that's a whole nother story. But I did all of that.
But it was like many weeks retreat somewhere.
5 weeks. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And it was really special as well.
And you did this all before your son was
born. All before the son. I was getting ready to be the best parent ever, zen, ready to, you know, just accept anything.
Okay.
Then he came.
And then what happened?
He came.
I brought
home that beautiful bundle and all of the meditation, all of the zen, everything went out the window, like completely.
Like
out
right
the
away.
Yeah, right away. Because I realized that I was.
Melissa, by the way, I think this is so, you know, relieving that you are like, you know, sharing this experience because I, you know, as a parent, I am sure that there are so many who feel the same.
Yeah.
Like, what happened in me when I got a parent? So, you know, even though you were like mindfulness teacher and everything, even you say that.
Mm-hmm. Because I got really good at becoming calm on the mat, you know, when I sat.
Mm-hmm.
But then I wasn't taking it with me into everyday life.
Mm.
And that was the issue. And it still is. Like, I'm still learning. So this little guy came home and, you know, I wanted him, as I wrote in the book, I wanted him on a schedule.
Mm.
I wanted him to stop crying. I wanted him to eat.
Mm.
And as a parent, you know that we actually don't have control over those things to a certain point.
Mm.
And so this guy became my little in-house
coach. 24/7 coach.
Like, 24/7.
Are you ready
exclusive.
To be coach, mom? He's like, I'm ready. Yeah.
It
What's
was an
coming?
Exclusive arrangement and it's still going on now, you know. But, you know, he helped me, you know, and I had this, and this was the thing that, you know, as I was, when I was writing the book and I was reflecting about that, you know, I used to sing this song to him and I'm going to get really emotional.
I mean, it doesn't matter. Yeah.
I used to sing this song by John Lennon called Beautiful Boy, and I don't know, you'll have to Google it to find out.
Yeah.
But the part of the lyrics are, you know, beautiful, beautiful, beautiful boy, and then life is what happens to you when you're making other plans.
Yeah, that's, I know, you know, it's, yeah.
And so.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was.
And Melissa, it's so touching because I'm, you know, we share all this. It's so how you share this experience that life is happening while we make other plans. We think that we are going to be something and
So life was happening, you know, and I was busy making other plans because I wanted the situation to be different than it was.
Mm.
And so then I realized that that's the essence of mindfulness, being at peace with the way life is, even when it's shit.
As it is, even though it's shit. It's so well said,
And, you know, as you mentioned John Kabat-Zinn before, who sort of brought mindfulness to the West.
West, you know,
he says, he describes it as putting out the welcome mat for life.
Oh, that's so nice. I've never heard that. Say it, putting out the welcome mat for life.
So it's just landing here and now and just going, okay, this is it. And just noticing how you feel. And you don't have to feel great. It's about feeling terrible or great, whatever, you know, but being okay with it, or just not even being okay with it, just a certain level of acceptance. And when I say acceptance, it doesn't mean to welcome it. You don't have to welcome something if you accept it. To accept something means to just go, okay, this is how it is, but then how am I going to move forward with it?
It's so well said. And you know what? You had these common myths about mindfulness in the book. And I really like this because I have to say that, okay, I've been doing whatever meditation because I grew up in a Christian family and we are in Christian tradition. There are also meditation tradition and blah, blah, blah. But this mindfulness, for a very long time, I felt that it was a very demanding way of looking things because I always heard that people said that you have to clear your mind. And now you said that common myths about mindfulness is that mindfulness clears the mind. So let's talk about this. This is your third myth. So.
So it's definitely not what it's about. Any sort of meditation or mindfulness is not about clearing the mind, but noticing what's happening in the mind.
So it's totally different, actually, because like you said that, okay, you have accomplished sometimes 3 seconds, you said in the book. You've been able to have a clear record. So mindfulness is not about clearing your mind. It's about recognizing and paying attention what's happening in your mind.
So what's happening when, for instance, I'll take it back again to meditation, which is a little bit different to mindfulness. Like meditation, let's say, in my opinion,
like that's your second myth, mindfulness is the same as meditation. That was your second myth. We can talk about these both.
So with regard to meditation, for instance, and the difference between meditation and mindfulness is, say, meditation is sitting, watching the mind, and maybe watching the breath. And then it can become a mindfulness meditation. But the purpose of the book was to point out different times of the day that you could do something with attention, pay attention to it, but still be moving around and doing life.
You don't have to sit in your mat or in your on your cushion or something, but you can just live your life.
And then that takes you to the thinking, because with thinking, we need to think. We need to set goals. We need to put one foot in front of the other. We need to go to work and all of this sort of stuff. So clearing the mind would be crazy, you know, like not the best idea, because you wouldn't be able to get anything done.
Be empty-minded all the time, like, please do not.
So basically what you do when you're meditating or when you're, you know, doing mindfulness is you're noticing the thoughts that come up. And you're practicing that. So, you know, it might be really frustrating for every time you do it, but to notice every time the thought comes up, and then you could start doing things like label a thought and go, oh, here comes a bit of, you know, anxiety right now, or, you know, oh, here comes a bit of anger, whatever. So you start to notice.
How did you just, you know, those are my two close friends.
And that's why we're close friends. Because I see you and you see me.
And anger.
They're my go-tos, for sure. So then when you practice and you get lots of, you know, practice, mm-hmm. but when I say practice, I'm talking, it can be 10 minutes a day. It can be 2 minutes a day. Mm. It can just be a breath.
Mm.
Just take a breath and just check in with your body.
Mm.
But the really cool thing that's taken me a really long time to understand is that when you meditate or when the thoughts come up, then you can see that you're not your thoughts. And, you know, this is a thing that when you meditate or, you know, partake in mindfulness, that you hear this line, you're not your thoughts, you're not your thoughts. And I never really used to get it. But when you start noticing your thoughts, that person or that awareness that's noticing your thoughts, who's that?
Who is it?
Well, who is it? That's the eternal question.
Yeah.
So, you know, like, you're not your thoughts. So, for instance, if I'm feeling...
Like, is it like, this is just a thought, you are not this? Okay, sorry.
Yeah. Well, it is. It's you're just a thought, you're not that. So then we don't have to put ourselves down. Because the thing about mindfulness as well, it's about being kind to yourself. It's kindfulness.
Yeah, kindfulness.
Know? Yeah. And so, you know, so then you have this thought of anger. Oh, and then you might go into this downward spiral. Oh, I'm always angry. Why does everybody piss me off? Da, 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 da.
Yeah. But then, people are assholes. Yeah,
people are assholes, you know, as it goes.
Yeah.
And so then what you could do is notice that the anger's coming. Mm. And this is with practice. And, you know, this is sort of not the end point, but it's something after trying for quite some, many years.
Just like, it's coming, notice, it's coming, welcome.
Okay. You know your triggers.
Yeah.
You see it and then you say welcome. And then you're like, oh, there you are, anger. Right.
Mm.
What are you trying to tell me?
Mm.
What's happening here? What can happen? So as soon as you notice the anger or the fear or the sadness, whatever it is, it's here.
Mm.
And when you're noticing that, you can't be that because it's the awareness that notices the thoughts.
So you can't be that.
And well, your awareness is pure.
Yeah.
So as soon as you notice something, you're creating kind of a little bit of an almost separation.
Almost something like a space between your thought and feeling and your awareness. Yeah.
And so, that's what it is. That's what mindfulness is. It's the space between.
Mindfulness is space.
It's the space between. It's the space between the thought comes.
Yeah.
There's the space. Oh, I'm doing some. I'm having this thought.
Mm-hmm.
And without mindfulness, normally you just react.
And you think that you are this person.
Yeah, you become consumed. Yeah. You're the angry person. Yeah. You're, you know, being taken over. Mm. But then you can go, here's the thought. What am I going to do with it? Okay, I'm going to be angry for 10 seconds, but I'm not going to let the mood take me for a few days.
Because I have all the right, because people are assholes. No. But that's nice. That's what mindfulness is. It's the space between.
Mm. And so then if you don't want to be mindful and get into sort of like woo, you know, because the other myth about mindfulness is it's for hippies or, you know, like you're blissed out all the time and whatever, you know, in psychological terms or it's like a 10-second rule or it's freedom of choice. There's lots of different terms that you can use. It's nothing new.
Yeah.
It's nothing new.
And your first myth actually here is that mindfulness is a religion.
Mm. Yes.
So where does it, like, people think that if they do it, then they have to believe in certain or not believe.
Or give up their own religion.
You said that you can still hold on to your preferred religion while engaging in mindful activity. So even whatever is your religion or you don't have a religion, this is,
it's pretty neutral. Mm. It just is, you know. And in the book, the tips that I give, there are about 30 different things you can do.
And they are practical. They are like, well, okay. But I really recommend in Finnish people, because actually this Finnish people, Finnish books layout is a little bit nicer than the English layout.
Yeah.
I don't
know. So that was second.
It was second.
The second version. So
but in Finnish, these are like small katse peiliin and mikä on pahinta, mitä voi tapahtua, ja tuo huomiosi takaisin tähän hetkeen. But in English, they are good. But I really like the Finnish layout.
Mm, thank you.
So
all of the tips there have no attachment to religion. Of course, meditation and mindfulness can come from Buddhism particularly. Yeah. But every religion actually has its own form of mindfulness, whether it be
like in
prayer.
In Christianity, Taoism, all kinds of It's like this.
They've all got their own version.
Yeah.
So mindfulness is kind of like the non-religious version of all of those, in a way.
Yeah, in a way. And then your fourth myth was that mindfulness is a quick fix for my problems. So because I have heard this many times, and also I have also catched myself in this idea that how can I still have this problem even though I have gone to this course and this course and this course, and why am I still being, you know, regressive and whatever?
Yeah. So mindfulness just helps you notice that and then be kinder to yourself when you do, when you are human.
Yeah.
Basically.
Yeah.
You know, so it's definitely not a quick fix because, yeah, I'm still a ball of anxiety. And
are you?
Oh,
like
yeah.
You, like you started that you were like very this, like maybe you didn't use the word reactive, but... but
yeah, I am reactive.
But in reacting into small things. So what has happened to that quality in your life?
Well,
is it like it's just it's still there but you accept it, or
it's my go-to, but I notice it more. So I notice it and then I don't get carried away with it, because you know, if you think of like emotions as a wave, emotions are the wave and then the moods are the tide. So you can either go out with the tide and stay there for days or swim back in. So now I don't go out for days.
Yeah.
I have the emotion,
yeah,
and then I have the mood attached to it, but then I notice it and just, you know, I don't know, be kinder to myself.
Yeah.
Basically.
What I liked about this book is because it's these tips that you are sharing, it's like they are so, they are easy to integrate into everyday life. Like you said, that sometimes I feel that, well, it's easy for Buddhist monks to be calm because they get to sit hours a day and, you know, walk in a great garden and listen to all kinds of bells
it's
and blah,
idyllic.
Blah, blah. So it's like, you know, it's easy. But we who are just living in this normal life, we have work, we have kids, we have family, we have, we need to get groceries and make food. So it's like there's a lot going on. And even to have that 15-minute space for yourself to maybe sit, sometimes I even...
Well, even that can be hard.
Yeah, even that can be hard. And like you said, that when your son was born, you probably didn't have the 50 minutes.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So then I worked out how to weave it into daily life, and that's where the book has come from.
Yeah.
So, yeah, do you want to do a little something?
What is your favorite? Like, what, if you, you don't have to think about the book, but if you think about your everyday life at the moment.
Yeah. I've got a favorite,
actually. What is it?
And it's not in the book.
Okay.
I know. Can you believe that?
Oh, well, you didn't write
an exclusive.
You have to write another one.
Yeah. It's an exclusive.
Okay.
So the one I like at the moment is, especially like during these difficult times recently, and I've been feeling my anxiety come up. And I've noticed that my thoughts are running away, you know, with the what ifs. What if I get sick? What if I can't go to Australia again? What if all of these what ifs? Right?
And what if the ceiling falls down? And what if the, you know,
exactly. My mind is full of them. If you want to hear a what if, I've got a list of them.
Okay.
Yeah. So
What is your what if list?
So the little exercise is turning the what ifs into the what is. Because, well, I know for me, I love to catastrophize. Just ask my husband, you know, I learned that word from him. You know, he's like, oh, here comes some catastrophizing again, you know, because everything's a little bit like this. So, but
And Makke, I of course know your husband because, he's
so,
not like this.
You can imagine him. Yeah, and he's not. So he's quick to, he's my other little meditation teacher.
Yeah.
But he's quick to point out when, you know, I'm going off. And so the what is usually actually nothing to really worry about, and really everything mostly is okay. So do you want to do a little little activity now?
Okay,
I'll take you through it.
Okay,
so just get into your mindful body.
Okay. I'll put this here,
put the book down. But basically you can do this eyes open or eyes shut, and actually it's probably better with your eyes open, but basically, when I catch my mind going into the what ifs, I go into the what is, and I use the senses. So we've got five senses in our body, well, the obvious ones anyway. And so if you can just remember, you know, eyes, ears, nose, mouth, body, touch, you know. So basically, you know, ground yourself with a nice deep breath. So just take a nice deep breath in. And even that in itself tells your brain, breathe out and elongate that breath. Mm-hmm. And just that lets your brain know that everything's okay, for starters. So then the what is what can you see right now? Like, what is? So just look at one thing. And if you've got your eyes closed, even noticing that there's black behind your eyelids. So what can you see? What is?
Mm.
And then what can you hear? Just one thing. So just place your attention on one thing that you can hear. And then what can you smell? What is right now? Is there anything in the air particularly that you can identify? And then can you taste anything? Maybe the cup of coffee you just had a sip of? Or... Mm. And then finally, what do you feel? So then that's a really nice way to ground yourself. Can you feel your body resting on the chair or your hands on your lap?
Mm.
Yeah, that's it.
It's so simple.
So simple.
So simple.
So turning the what if to the what is. So what is happening right in this moment? Because that's what mindfulness helps you do, come back to now.
Like if I'm like wondering that, okay, what if I get sick and what if my children don't want to be with me when I'm old and what if my husband dies or what if I go bankruptcy or what if
and they're
I don't
all
have
things
any clients
that might happen.
Anymore.
Yeah, they're all things that might happen. This. But when you bring yourself back into the present moment, you notice really that everything's okay.
Mm.
So it's a really nice way to soothe yourself. Mm.
To kind of come from the catastrophe fantasies.
Yeah.
Mm. Oh, thank you.
That's it.
How often do you do this practice?
24 hours a day.
About the breathing. You said, like, we started with the breathing, and I have shared it openly that I have had a lot of difficulties with my breathing.
Mm.
And that's why... Actually, mindfulness and meditation, which I've been practicing for, let's say, basically all of my life, because I used to grow in a environment where we did those kind of things. But it didn't give me that peacefulness that people were always talking about.
Mm-hmm.
So how is it like if I would have just gone to mindfulness courses?
Mm-hmm.
And I would say that breathing deeply just brings me more anxiety.
Mm.
What do you say then? Or how would you help?
The way I would help would be something like, you know, the breath can be and usually is the main anchor in mindfulness training, you know, because anchor as in just as you throw an anchor out when you're on a boat, it steadies the boat.
Mm-hmm.
The breath is a really good anchor because it steadies the body.
Mm-hmm.
But then I would just choose another anchor. And so another anchor might be your hands.
You were talking about your hands. You were talking about breathing, easiest. Hands, and then what was the third one?
The body.
Body. Of course. Like,
so, well, everything that you've got.
Yeah.
And that's what I was trying to say, that you don't need any special tools. You know, you just need yourself.
Oh, that's because, true. You were talking about. So if you don't want to use the breath, how do you use your hands?
You just close your eyes again. It's probably better to close your eyes for this one.
Mm-hmm.
And what you do is just place your attention on your hands.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're at home watching this, do this now. Close your eyes and place your attention on your hands and just notice the volume of space there in your hands. And you might even detect some tingling or warmth. And then that's it. You open your eyes again. So what you've just done is gotten out of the thinking and put your attention on something tangible and it just sort of is grounding, you know.
And just in these short mini versions, because sometimes what I like about this idea is that these are just few seconds, actually.
Mm.
You don't have to have the 15 minutes even or the 50 minutes or whatever or do the perfect body scanning from certain order.
Mm.
But you can just start from wherever.
Well, just start from where you're at.
Yeah.
you know, rather than dive into the deep end. Just start where you are. So if that means opening your eyes in the morning and just noticing the sheets on you or the light filtering through the window, something really simple, then that's just, again, taking you out of this what if thinking mind and what has been thinking mind into just the moment. And then what happens really naturally is when you sort of set yourself an intention to do something like that, you naturally increase the moments. And that's the beautiful thing. And that's what I meant when I said like it was kind of a reverse engineering. So I started with the meditation and then moved into the smaller moments because I had to, because I couldn't sit for 15, 20, 30 minutes a day with my son who needed me. So I had to find ways to become grounded and out of the anxiety and into the moment that way. And so I think it's really possible to do those things and then just take it where you like.
Yeah.
You know?
Not to have a certain order. What if, like, I noticed this being a reactive, because I feel that I have been and I am quite a reactive person, also very sensitive in many ways. And I have noticed in my life that when I was younger, I used to have all kinds of neuroses that this had to be like this, and my bread had to be, you know, the butter had to be a certain way. And if it wasn't a certain way, I would give it back to my dad and do it better. And, you know, and then I would... I would smell everything and how does it smell and all kinds of neuroses, blah, blah, blah. So when you do mindfulness, and but you're talking about paying attention, so is it like, what if I hear the wind and then it starts annoying and I get annoyed? Or, you know, certain noises or whatever.
And you notice that you're annoyed.
You just
and you say, I'm human.
I'm annoyed.
And I'm okay. I'm okay just the way I am. Neuroses or not.
Like, just, I'm okay. Melissa, I don't want to be okay the way I am.
But you are. That's the thing. We're all
smelling
okay.
Smelling everything.
Yeah. But we're all okay.
Yeah.
And that's the thing.
We don't, our neuroses.
And until we start accepting that we're okay, then we're going to have this struggle. You know, and because as Jon Kabat-Zinn says and has written a book entitled Wherever You Go, There You Are.
That's well said. Wherever you go, there you are.
That's it. So you better get on the...
Shit.
On the exactly.
Yes. How did I... why am I here? So it's like, I mean, Melissa, we are all are actually a little bit crazy, though, aren't we? We are weird. We are crazy. We are awkward. I like this... one person who talks about awkwardness and it's how important it is actually to just admit that we are and you say in your book that don't take it so seriously. It was your fifth somewhere here, I remember.
The extra step.
It was like don't
one.
Because
that's how it goes. You start to become an expert in something and then you, you know, think you're really cool. You want to tell everybody else about it. Everybody else has to do it.
I have to. And we let's go through it. I thought it was so funny. Like, it was the process how you become mindful. Okay, let's take that one. Simple steps to modern mindfulness.
There's swearing in there. Alert.
Yeah. The first one, you become mindful. And then the step two, try to tell others how to live their lives based on what you know. I love this. Yeah.
Because don't we all do that?
Because I just got interested in this. Now I want to tell you how you should live your life.
Yeah. And even when I might not be living my life
that
way.
Did you go through this step
totally.
Too?
Totally. Yeah.
How was it?
Oh.
Or are
humbling.
You still...
I'm still there.
No, I haven't seen that you would be there, but you, did you... You experience it?
Yeah. Yeah. Of course.
And then you become even more mindful.
Yeah.
And the step four is realize you know nothing and finally shut the fuck up.
And some would say that I haven't really shut up just yet, but still, yeah.
And then the step five is learn to listen.
Yeah.
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 It's so true. This is true. This is how it goes.
Yeah.
We get interested about something and then we think that we are masters and we...
And then you realize you know
I'm
nothing.
I'm in a position that I can tell you how you should live your life.
Mm-hmm.
Ah, but then then you have the steps six. Don't take it all too seriously.
So I'm trying not to do
playfulness. Yeah, you have a lot of playfulness in you.
Oh, do I?
Yeah,
that's the way I cope with my life.
Yeah. I mean, you're always, you know, even though we discuss about deep things, and then you always have this bubbling side in you. So is it like, have you always been like that, or is it just something that you realize that it's actually, you know, when you want to understand life or, you know, be mindful that the humor and that you are able to be spontaneous, it's part of it?
Yeah, I think I just learned it recently because I've always been like silly and bubbly, but like when I got into things in the past, I thought that I had to be an expert in those things, you know, and serious.
Yeah.
And, you know, and perhaps you do have to be like that. Perhaps your master meditators and master mindfulness experts are looking at this and thinking, oh my God, you know, but also life is short. So that's why I added step six, because, you know, what's the point?
Did this Buddha monk that you, the first retreat you told that where you went, was it he? It was he, yeah.
It was, it was a man.
Yeah, they are all men now.
Yeah, it's a,
women
it's
can a, not be.
No, they can, but it was a monastery, basically. Okay. So then they would open the monastery for lay people like me and you to go for mini retreats and things like
that. So did he laugh or was he all serious?
No, there was laughing.
Was it? Yeah.
And actually, when I went for later ones, you can have time sitting with the monk and ask questions and where you're struggling and all of that sort of stuff. And I used to ask questions like, oh, what do I do? Like, I'm so bored. It's so boring. I just sit there and I'm just so bored. And he's like, so am I.
He's teaching you.
So, you know.
So what? And then what happened? Then you were just bored.
And then I just realized, don't take it so seriously. Be bored. It's okay.
Isn't it funny, though, how we think that if we are bored, we have to find something else, or if we are annoyed, we think that it's a sign that we have to do or test another diet or whatever.
And that's just the mind throwing a tantrum. So then if you can catch the mind throwing the tantrum and go, oh, there you are again, you know, you.
Yeah.
There you are. I see you.
And like some use this concept of this monkey mind in Buddhist.
Yes.
Is it a concept that you like to use?
Yeah. But I heard recently somebody say that poor old monkeys, they get such a bad rap because actually, you know, there's nothing wrong with the monkey mind.
It's they're cute.
You know.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's the way we are. So it's just a matter of noticing and accepting that that's how we are and then, you know, choosing to be different if we want to be.
Yeah.
If we want to be. Like,
So life can be boring, life can be annoying, life can be all kinds of things, but it's not a sign that we have to change something from our external world.
Well, because life mostly is boring.
Yeah.
Like, really. And that's what mindfulness is all about. Because
Melissa.
here comes
This is frustrating.
Here comes the boring, deep stuff, but it is boring. And that's why practicing mindfulness is really helpful, because it's when you're practicing these little moments that you're actually living life and not looking ahead to the holiday that you're going to have for 1 week of 52 weeks a year.
Going to Santorini.
Yeah, and that's great.
Yeah.
And it's wonderful. And you can have all the photos and the memories, and that's wonderful. But for the 51 weeks of the year, which is just everyday life, you've got to find ways to be in it.
That's why spring was so good for us, wasn't it? With all the corona, everything that
it's really confronting.
We were like really stuck with our boring life, with all the duties
with
and everything.
That's it.
No escape.
Yep.
Wow. You know what? Thank you for doing this work, and I think that this kind of knowledge and all this, if we all could just practice a little bit, even a little bit more of all this. I think that life is it's a good place.
Yeah.
It's a good place. So I think that the work that you are doing, it helps at least me, and I hope other people too, to realize that this is a good place.
Mm. Thank you, Ilona. It was really nice to have this conversation with you.
Yeah, it was. Thank you.
I appreciate you.
I appreciate you. Thank you.